You can see my tree where I place ribbons. I like to change the ribbons every year, and you see that I didn't change it for 1 year, so I started cutting it through the tree, but I have a nice ribbon around my tree. Just till next May, and then I'll place some ribbons, because you can see right here, the old ribbons were cutting through the tree. But this is not what I want to talk about today. I want to talk today about the witch's bottles. Or the witch's balls that I have here hanging on this tree. Now, if you ever look at a Christmas tree and you see the Christmas tree balls on the tree, believe it or not, a lot of those Christmas tree balls and the Christmas tree itself has its origins in ancient pagan traditions. Spears or balls were placed on a pine tree to represent protection, okay? And every time one of the spears would fall, it was said that it was breaking a curse or black magic. So traditionally, witches place balls on trees or entranceways to protect from the evil eye, from lower level spirits, earthbound spirits, and they're placed by the tree near the house or the entranceway to a doorway. So that Christmas tree that you use during Christmas, it has its roots in ancient pagan traditions, as well as the Christmas ball that is placed on the tree. Those balls are also to ward off evil eye, negative spirits, lower level spirits. And it is said that when a ball falls from a tree, it is breaking the influence of evil eye, envy, or a lower level spirit. Now, this witch's ball has been in my house since I moved in, and this one my godson made, which I will leave a link down below. The witch's balls are hung by a tree, by the entrance of the house, or by the doorways of a house, and they are never removed from the house or from the, you know, where you hang them. They're supposed to stay there until they completely fall off. If they fall off, it is said that they had picked up a negative spirit, evil eye, black magic. See this liquid right here? Now, do you see this liquid right here? The witch's balls come with no liquids. Some witch's balls have charms, some have nothing. They usually come clear. This is representing that it's picking up negative vibration. This is just from the rain, from weather. Okay, so it's never removed until it falls, and then it's supposed to break. So a witch's ball is never to be removed from the tree. It is left there until it falls and breaks. And that right there is a symbol that it picked up negative vibrations, any evil eye or evil spirits or entity that the ball may have absorbed. Again, the witch's ball comes clear. And this is just water from nature. And you can see it's brown, so it's picking up all that stuff that you do not want within the house. This was done by my godson. This is the first witch's ball that I placed here when I moved in. It's been here almost 10 years. This one I just placed a couple of months ago. And it was clear, and now it is, you see that water? is getting full. This is all the negative vibrations and negative influence that I do not want within my house. In old traditions, people who are accused of witchcraft or witches were believed to be women or people who had no souls. They were hollow creatures. So when they were persecuted as witches, many of them were thrown, tied to a chair and thrown into water. If they were to float, that was enough proof that they were witches. And if they sank and they left them down, if the woman who was accused as a witch, if they sank and didn't float, then they were not a witch. But sadly, traditionally, they'd leave them down there enough so that the person would drown. So either way, the person would lose. So believe it or not, ancient traditions believed that witches had no souls, so they could float over water. Witches' balls and variations of witches' balls also are in other traditions. In many African traditions, you will see people hang small bottles of liquor on trees as offerings to the spirits. So it is not just necessarily European. In Native American cultures, Taino cultures, higueras of bones of people who were disturbed or a person who was of great power, the bones were placed in higueras. Higueras, a hollow gourd, were hung on trees so that a shaman could absorb the powers of that, maybe let's say that shaman, or so they could uplift the soul of a person, of an Indian who lived a tormented life. They often didn't bury them, they would hang them. They would place the bones in a gourd and hang them on the trees so that that spirit in the afterlife would find some form of elevation. So you will find this in many forms of, you know, different cultures around the world. But this one right here is the European witch's bottle. Now, this witch's ball right here is facing an eastern doorway. And it also collects liquid, but the sun, the morning sun, does evaporate it. So the symbol of the evaporation is that it is evaporating any negativity from entering into the house. So I have this one in my back door, which is an eastern facing wall. And then I have the one in the front of the house. But you can see this one doesn't have as much liquid because the sun evaporates it, which is good because you want to evaporate any negativity from entering into your house. Now you can tell if a witch is nearby by the entrance of their house. I got some protective amulets here, walking sticks, and in New England you can tell a witch's house. There's usually wind chimes, bells, mirrors, evil eye charms, chimes, pentacles, pentagrams, witches' bottles or witches' balls. Inside the house I have also you can see, just charms on the doorway. But witches' balls inside my house I have for the evil eye, protection for the evil eye. Inside my house I have a mirror. So in New England, you can often tell a witch's house, a brujo's house, by their charms and stuff. Right there, there's a coco. They need a change this year. And I got some metal so negative spirits don't pass by. In the back of the house, I have railroad spikes. So you can see, I gotta clean this up. Incense sticks, because I burn a lot of incense here. My spirits. See the witch's bottle right there. So here are the witch's bottles. I don't know if you can see the name of the company, Villafane witch ball. Okay, and I will leave a link down below to their Etsy shop. If you can see that. But a witch's bottle works pretty much like a mirror that you place in front of the front door. It absorbs the magic, it deflects any evil eye, negative spirits, and it also absorbs into it or traps in a spirit, especially malignant spirits from entering into the house. This is just a prototype of the witch's ball, and I know that his newer witch's balls do not have this hanging. Now they're pretty much straightforward, and I'll play some pictures above, but I'm gonna leave a link to his Etsy shop. But like I said, they attract the evil eye, they attract negative spirits, and that gets absorbed into the witch's bottle and gets trapped. Then it's placed by an eastern wall, usually where it reflects the energies of the sun, and the sun destroys that energy from entering into the house. So I'm going to leave a link down below to their Etsy shop. Now, David Villafane also makes tarot boxes, and I've talked about them before. Here's two designs. In the beginning of the video, you saw that was him actually showing me his tarot box. He will work with you. You see this one has a golden bronze clasp, while this one has a silver clasp. He can use any color leather that you want, any design that you want. Here's a design that he did for my partner Terry, and then mine is just pretty much simple. And they fit, it's this clasp right there, and they fit random sizes of tarot decks. So here's a tarot deck within it that fits nice and snug. This is like the golden tarot. Let me show you this one. And this one, these are well made. You can see there's enough room to fit various sizes of tarot decks, standard tarot decks. Okay, so I'm gonna leave a link down below to his products, his Etsy shop and his website. But you can see he will work with you if you want a brown leather tarot box, a black one. You can have a copper or a golden clasp. You can choose the design that you want. You can choose the color of leather that you want. This one is the all-seeing eye with a silver clasp. So I'm gonna leave a link down below. He also sells witches bottles, which are, like I said in the beginning of the video, placed. They're used like mirrors in front of the door. They're used to absorb the evil eye, negative vibration from entering into the house, to deflect it. And spirits, wandering spirits, often get trapped into the bottle, and they cannot escape. And then the sun usually is placed by an eastern door or window, where the energies of the sun will give light to that spirit from entering into the home. And like I said, he did fix this clasp. This is just a prototype. So I'm going to show you some of the pictures, you know, of some of the witch bottles that he's done. And also look down below. I'm going to leave a link to his Etsy shop. Villafane witch bottles. And David Villafane also does. He's Colombian artist. His wife is Puerto Rican. They're both espiritistas, spiritualists. And he does tarot boxes. They do, I think they have a Madama doll and a Gitana doll in their Etsy shop. But he will work with you. So I'm going to leave a link down below just to check out his, and look, they stand nice on the table. So I'm going to leave a link down below to his Etsy shop. So here are the seeds. Just going to carefully add water. Let these guys soak for 4 days in a dark room. Then I'll plant them. I'll place them in a fertilizer, dirt, and see if I grow. I already have a Ceiba, but these are the Ceiba trees. Can you imagine that from this seed grows in Puerto Rico and in the Caribbean, a 100-foot tall tree from this little seed. The king of the trees, La Ceiba. So I just want to show my godson that from the seed that he sent me of the Ceiba is starting to grow. And these are little baby Ceiba trees. And to think that in Puerto Rico and in the Caribbean, these are sacred trees, but to think that in Puerto Rico, these trees grow to be 100 feet taller. This is my Ceiba. I keep her small because I am in New England. Try to keep her small and trimmed. So around a couple years old. This was the first seeding that I tried. And these are baby Ceibas that I planted here along this. I'm gonna probably change the pot before the ending of the summer and let these root out a little bit stronger. I always keep it by an eastern window in the winter, nice and warm. And I mimic the Caribbean weather. Here in New England, it gets very cold, but I mimic the Caribbean weather. I make sure it's humid. But I just want to show you, David, that from the seeds you sent me, there's one, two, three, four. I think they're all growing. And five Ceibitas. I'll probably put them all in different pots. These are the Ceiba, La Ceiba. So this weekend, I got the privilege of spending time with Lailani and her boyfriend, Archie, and they brought me this gift. They brought me some gifts, but this one really stood out. I love it. And this is what we call in Spanish, el higo, or la higuera. And in English, it is known as the fig tree. And I have it on this elephant stand. But this is like higuera. Everyone knows I love plants. Just see it right there. The fig tree, like higuera. And this is what I would like to talk to you about. The magical and spiritual and folklore and legend. A little bit of it. Of like higuera. Or el higo. The figo. The fig tree. It's just a baby. Next year I'll repot it into a bigger pot. So here's my fig tree, and the fig is the first tree mentioned in the Bible. It is known as the tree of life, and then the second one was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I might be saying that wrong, but it is mentioned in the Bible a couple of times. It was also mentioned in Mark 11, 12, number 20. When Jesus curses a fig tree that doesn't give him fruit to eat, and when he cursed the fig tree, it died. It is sacred in many traditions and religions. It is said that Siddhanta Gautama, or the Buddha, sat under a Budai tree, and the Budai tree was a fig tree, and this is where he found enlightenment, or the revelations for the foundations of what would be a Buddhism. The fig tree in magic is used for fertility, for love, for protection, enlightenment, power, and wisdom. Okay. Some say that when Adam and Eve ate a fruit, the fruit from the Garden of Eden, that it was a fig or an apple. But what it is known is when they were cast out of the Garden of Eden, they made clothing from the leaves of the fig tree, the figo. So the fig tree is mentioned in many religions all over the world, Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianity. In ancient Greeks, I think it is sacred to Demeter, and was a gift to the earth or to humans by Dionysus. It is also said that when Gaia gave birth to Zeus, she hid Zeus from Cronos by wrapping him up in fig leaves. Okay, so fig is very sacred in many traditions. And like I said, it is known as the tree of life. The tree of life, it is the first, one of the first trees mentioned in the Bible. Again, it is used for fertility, love, protection, luck. It is used for divination, what else, enlightenment, power, wisdom. Some people say that it could be also used for black magic, especially if you want to separate a couple and they're growing a fig tree. You would write the name of the person, of the people you want to separate, and you would burn the leaves and sprinkle that in your powders or around the home of the person who you want to separate. Now, I don't personally do that, but I'm just talking about, you know, forms of magic that do use that. Look at how beautiful these leaves are. So right now it's a baby, and I'm gonna repot it next year and keep it as a beautiful house plant. You can see I love my plants in my house. So the fig, el higo, a figo, a huera, is a masculine tree ruled by the element, I think it's the element of fire. It is masculine. And I think it is ruled by the planet or by Jupiter. So I just wanted to show you this beautiful plant that I received from Lailani and her boyfriend Archie. Beautiful people who came to visit me from New York. And I love it. Thank you very much. I have it on this beautiful elephant stand. It's a nice little pot, and I'm gonna cherish it for the rest of my life. I love this plant. Thank you very much. This is the figo, el higo, the fig. Sycomancy is the art of divining with the fig leaves. And the way it is done, it is you write your petition on a fig leaf. You cut off a fig leaf and you write your petition and you keep it in a place, a safe place. If the fig leaf dries and shrivels and loses its color, the answer to your question is no. But if the leaf dries with a green shape and it retains its shape, then the answer is a favorable, it's a favorable, you know, to the question that you write on the fig leaf. So you would cut a leaf and you would write your petition and you would ask a yes or a no question. Again, if the leaf dries and loses its color, then this is a no to your question. But if it retains its color and it stays nice and green and it dries green, this is favorable and this is a yes. It is also used for protection. Some people who want to protect a person who's traveling, you would cut a fig leaf and you would wrap it up and give it to someone who is traveling and have that person, you know, keep it safe. This will promote a safety within travel, protection within travel, safe return. You could also give a piece of a branch to a person and have the person bury the branch by the house so that the person will have a safe return home. So this is how it's used in divination and how it is used in our protective magic. This is the figo, la higuera, el higo. Another form of sycomancy, sycomancia, is to take a few, let's say you have two or three choices and you're not sure which way to go, which route to go. And you would take two, three, depending on how many things you're not sure what to choose. And you're gonna write on each leaf, you're gonna cut it out and you're gonna write, you know, the choices that you need. The ones that dry out are definitely what you should totally ignore, while the one that retains its greenness, that would be definitely favorable, okay? So you can cut leaves out. This is sycomancy. You can cut out leaves if you have something to choose. Let's say partners, let's say job, business, home, whatever. If you have more than one choice and you don't know which one to choose, then you would take some figo leaves and you would write. The one that stays green is favorable while the ones that dry out would be not so favorable. So that's a form of using the figo or ego in forms of divination or as an oracle, and is known as sycomancy. So this weekend I was lucky enough to spend the day with Lailani and her boyfriend Archie. And Lailani has a business. It is called The Magical Solution, and that is her name, and that's her phone number, and I will link her webpage down below. But before I go into this bag, she brought me some dried mugwort, which you can see right here. She just brought me some dried mugwort from her garden, and I thought that was very sweet. I'm gonna powder this down and use it in powders. But she brought me some of her products, okay, which I'm going to look. Let's see what this is. This is the Magical Solution Love Bath Balm. This is a bath balm, you know, one of those balms that you throw into the bath and it does the fizzling. I like the packaging, very nice package. I haven't opened it yet, so I don't know how it smells like. So I'm just gonna place that into the side, see what else she brought me. Or she gave me, I should say. Hot foot powder. Okay, so hot foot powder is used if you have someone negative in your life and you want to remove them from your life, then you will sprinkle hot foot powder to remove people from your life or around you. And this stuff smells really good. I smell patchouli. I smell some patchouli in there, but it smells really good. I like it. So she brought me some hot foot powder. I'll take the light out because it's a little too shiny, so you can't even see. So let me take out the light. Okay. Yeah, this is much better. So this is her packaging. I like her packaging. I like the color that she chose, that royal blue. This is hot foot powder. And that's her logo. What else did she give me? Pretty Woman cologne spray. Now, mind you, I'm not a female, I'm not a woman, but I sprayed this early. I wanted to smell it. I was curious, and it's got this nice, soft smell. I sprayed it an hour ago, and I still smell it on me, and it's very sweet, very summery, so I like the smell of it, and I definitely recommend it. You can find her products in the webpage that I will leave a link down below, and I don't know if you can see that, but it is The Magical Solution, Lailani, and that's her phone number. And what else did she give me? Cleopatra oil. Cleopatra oil is good for seduction, good for seducing, for passion, for love. I haven't smelled this yet, so I'm going to open that up later and finish the video. Bunch of paper, get that out of the way. I think the last thing that she gave me is some vanvan oil. Now, vanvan oil, I wanted to get it blurry. Vanvan oil is used to cleanse away from negative vibrations, negative spirits. It's used to draw money, to attract wealth, fortune, to bring influential people in your life. Usually vanvan oil is used on, like, let's say an amulet or a talisman, and you want to charge the amulet, then you would sprinkle some vanvan oil on your talisman or amulet. If you're going bingo or lottery, then you would take a coin. Here's a copper coin of, why is everything so blurry? This is a Queen Hippolyta, and on this other side is Hercules. So you want to attract some money while you're doing bingo, and you want to create a charm, then you would sprinkle a little bit on a coin or something to attract money. So yeah, and that's it. And thank you very much, Lailani. I'm gonna leave a link down below. This is vanvan oil. This is Cleopatra oil. Some hot foot powder, And last but not least, Pretty Woman perfume, which actually smells good. I like it on me too. It's not that feminine, it's not that masculine, so it could be used for both. It's nice for a nice spring day. And she gave me this, she gave me the mugwort, and she gave me the fig tree, so I really appreciate it. Anyways, this is Francisca Brujo Luis. I really appreciate it. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, please hit that like button. Please leave a comment. If you are a person who is starting out a business and would like me to review it, get in contact me. I'd be more than happy to promote. I love to promote up-and-coming spiritual people and their products. So if you have a product that you would like me to review or make a video of, I'm more than happy to do so. And, oh, yeah, and I forgot her magical solution, love bath bomb. But anyways, so this is Francisca Brujo Luis. I hope you enjoyed this bunch of videos. They're just a bunch of clips of videos. And thank you to Lailani from the Magical Solution, Lailani and Archie, and David Villafane and Marcela Villafane from Villafane Spiritual spiritual supplies, I guess. I'm gonna leave a link to both of their web pages and their Etsy's and their stores, online stores, so if you're just curious to buy. So that is Lailani's, and this is right here, David Villafane's, or the Villafane's witch bottle, which I placed pictures of. You know, this is just a prototype. They changed it. They made the witch bottle, and they make beautiful tarot deck boxes. Really sturdy, nice prices, really affordable. They do also muñecas of gitanas and madamas. So go check out their Etsy shop. Anyways, this is Francisca Brujo Luis. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you do, please hit that like button, please subscribe, and please leave a comment down below. Francisca Brujo Luis, Santo Sanse.
En un monte muy lejano, soy un ruido misterioso, y era el viejo candelo que bajaba misterioso. Mira, yo no soy de aquí, yo vine de San Andrés, y la traigo yo aquí, pa' que la quiera aprender.